Honorable Rex Gatchalian and the official party. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the Philippine National Anthem to be led by the Bangko Sentral singers. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. We now begin with the official welcome remarks, and I now call upon Dr. Eli M. Remolona Jr., Governor of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome to the 2023 Global Policy Forum of the Alliance for Financial Inclusion. The Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas is honored to host this year's gathering of financial inclusion champions and advocates from the Philippines and other parts of the globe. We are joined this morning by the Honorable Secretary of the Philippines, Department of Social Welfare and Development, Rex Gatchalian. The Honorable Secretary of the Philippine Department of Finance, Benjamin Jokno. Board Chair of the Alliance for Financial Inclusion, Governor Ariff Ali of the Reserve Bank of Fiji. AFI Executive Director, Dr. Alfred Hannig. Founding Chair of the Asia School of Business and former Governor of Bank Negara, Malaysia, Dr. Zeti, Aziz. Colleagues from central banks and financial regulators, partners and stakeholders from government, business, and NGOs, resource persons, the media, and special guests. We have about 700 delegates from over 70 countries signed up for this year's Global Policy Forum. We thank you all for joining us here. We can look forward to diverse, rich, and multifaceted discussions on how we can more effectively uplift the lives of the marginalized and the excluded through financial inclusion. Gains in financial inclusion are being made in varying degrees from country to country, but there are also setbacks that we must reckon with. Climate change is one. In the Philippines, for instance, stronger and more frequent storms destroy agricultural crops and other livelihoods. These result in income losses that drive the underprivileged deeper into poverty. Our sustainability agenda, therefore, is one that will be inherently inclusive. On the other hand, there are challenges that present both risks and opportunities. Among others, the pandemic-induced lockdowns that kept people indoors caused business closures and job loss. But the same lockdowns triggered a boom in online selling and digital payments for goods and services from businesses that were quick to adapt to mobility constraints. This raised the share of digital transactions to retail payments in our country from 14% in 2019 to 42% in 2022. Many consumers opened digital accounts or e-wallets. Government also used digital accounts to distribute cash assistance during the pandemic. As a result, mobile wallet ownership surged from 8% in 2019 to 36% in 2021. This helped raise the overall number of Filipinos with transaction accounts from 29% in 2019 to 56% in 2021, equivalent to 22 million Filipinos who became financially included in the span of 2 years. This milestone is important to us. Transaction accounts are gateways to financial inclusion. We have seen depositors improve their lives from gaining access to other financial services, such as loans, insurance, and investments. For instance, insurance helps farmers recover faster from losses inflicted by natural calamities, while small business loans help micro entrepreneurs expand or pivot their businesses. Indeed, while we have a long way to go in our financial inclusion journey, millions of Filipinos are already benefiting from our multi-pronged financial inclusion initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen, I stand on the shoulders of giants. The BSP's financial inclusion journey started during the term of then-Governor Rafael Buenaventura. The General Banking Law, which was enacted in 2000, mandated the BSP to recognize microfinance as a legitimate banking activity. As a response, he declared microfinance as the BSP's flagship program to help alleviate poverty in our country. His vision was to bring microfinance to every province in the Philippines. He called on banks to develop microfinance programs, provided incentives to banks that set up dedicated microfinance units, created a microfinance team within the central bank, and frequently requested journalists to write about microfinance. His successor was Governor Armando Tetangco Jr. He saw how microcredits could be so empowering for the entrepreneurial poor and sometimes even uplift the communities around them. For 12 years, Governor Tetangco chaired the national annual search for the best micro-entrepreneurs and witnessed how thousands were liberated from poverty by economic activities financed by microcredit. He said, "We learned that financial inclusion is complementary to our primary objective of price and financial stability. Also, individuals who are adequately informed and included are effective economic agents." Under Governor Tetangco's term, the BSP expanded its focus from microfinance to financial inclusion. The goal was to give millions of Filipinos access to a broader range of financial services. The BSP also developed multi-sectoral partnerships to promote financial inclusion. This was the foundation for the Interagency Committee to implement the national strategy for financial inclusion. It was Governor Nestor Espinilla Jr. who led the BSP's adoption of digital technology for financial inclusion. To him, digital technology brings scale and affordability to financial transactions, and it opens new possibilities for delivering financial services, even to difficult-to-serve markets within our archipelago of 7,641 islands. Governor Espinilla was ready to give innovation a chance if it can move financial inclusion forward. He used the regulatory sandbox framework of test and learn to allow BSP supervised institutions, third-party service providers, and new players to offer financial products and services using new technology to a limited number of customers in a controlled environment. This then informs the appropriate regulatory and supervisory approach. Last year, AFI started giving out the Nestor Espinilla Jr. Financial Inclusion Award, which recognizes institutions that demonstrate outstanding commitment toward innovation and the use of technology to further financial inclusion. It was AFI's way of honoring Governor Espinilla's contributions to the advancement of financial inclusion through innovation. On behalf of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas and Governor Espinilla's family, represented here today by his wife, Tess, we thank you, AFI. To Governor Benjamin Jokno, BSP's inclusion story is one of evolution and laying the solid foundation that would carry us through ordinary and extraordinary times. It was under his term as chair of the NSFI Steering Committee that the Presidential Memorandum Circular number 97, dated June 23, 2022, was issued, institutionalizing the whole of government support for the implementation of the National Strategy for Financial Inclusion 2022-2023. The circular also declared the adoption of financial inclusion as a development agenda at both the national and subnational levels. Governor Felipe Medalla, for his part, walked his talk on financial inclusion. With a team from the BSP, he went to public markets to engage market vendors, public transport drivers, and small businesses to shift to the safer and more convenient digital payments platform through PalengQR PH Plus. To Governor Medalla, it is imperative that the BSP remains focused on doing its best to fulfill financial stability and a secure and efficient payment system. By doing so, we will have a strong foundation on which to expand our national financial inclusion program. And now it is my turn. What an honor to join these champions, these giants of financial inclusion. Like my predecessors, I am fully committed to broaden and deepen the reach of financial inclusion toward financial health, resilience, and a better life for millions of Filipinos. My previous posts at the Bank for International Settlements exposed me to how financial inclusion has been evolving. In fact, I was the BIS chief representative for Asia and the Pacific when the BIS co-hosted with the BSP a research conference on financial inclusion. This was in 2016 in Cebu City. And now the BSP is hosting the 2023 AFI Global Policy Forum. All these should serve me and the BSP in good stead. With the continuing support of our colleagues, partners, and stakeholders here and overseas, we at the Team BSP are confident that we will continue to help improve the lives of our unserved, underserved, and unreached. Together, let us address AFI's call for stability, sustainability, and inclusivity for shared prosperity. Thank you, everyone. Marami pong salamat at mabuhay tayong lahat.
Ladies and gentlemen, Governor Eli M. Remolona, Jr. Thank you very much, Governor, for those inspiring words. Now, ladies and gentlemen, for our first opening remarks, we welcome Ariff Ali, Governor of the Reserve Bank of Fiji and AFI Board Chair.
Dr. Eli Remolona, Jr., Governor, Bangko Sentral, Pilipinas. Honorable Rex Gatchalian, Secretary, Philippines Department of Social Welfare and Development. Honorable Benjamin Jocno, Finance Secretary. Honorable Bruce Tolentino, Member of Board, Bank Central, Pilipinas. Dr. Alfred Hannig, Executive Director, AFI. Tan Sri Datin, Dr. Zeti Akhtar, former Governor Bank Negara, Malaysia, and founding chair of Asia School of Business. Honorable ministers, governors, presidents, superintendents, deputy governors, central bank leaders, AFI funding partners, private sector partners, and knowledge partners, ladies and gentlemen. Nisa Bula Vinaka is the Fijian way of saying warm greetings to you all. It is a real honor for me to welcome you all this morning as the incoming chair of the AFI board. I'm privileged to be in the company of distinguished guests and participants from across the world who have converged in this beautiful country to discuss our financial inclusion progress. Warren Buffett's quote that someone sitting in the shade today is because someone planted a tree a long time ago is very much relevant to AFI. 15 years ago, AFI, along with some member countries and donors present in the room today, planted a seed on financial inclusion. That tree has sprouted and grown, providing financial inclusion lifeline to millions worldwide. Today, we sit in the shadow of provided by the tree through this GPF, and through this GPF continue to care for and water it so that it can grow even more, even further, and provide shade for even more people. Let me also take this opportunity to thank our gracious host, Dr. Remolona, and the staff of Bangko Sentral, Pilipinas, for the warm welcome and all the magnificent arrangements made to ensure the success of this GPF. As host of the 2016 GPF, I know firsthand the substantial organizational effort required to make this event successful. I wish to congratulate Governor Remolona on his appointment to the Central Bank. Your vast experience, international experience in central banking, academia, and the private sector is impressive, and we all look forward to working with you during your term as governor. I also extend my appreciation to the management team of AFI under the strong leadership of Dr. Alfred Hannig for your unwavering dedication and hard work throughout the year. Your tireless efforts have played a pivotal role in driving AFI and setting the pace for working groups and regional initiatives in their bid for success. AFI is probably the only organization established to focus primarily on financial inclusion, a vision it upholds despite the various challenges it faces. AFI is a resilient organization which empowers its people and is an unrivaled leader in the financial inclusion space. As we reflect on the past year's accomplishments and look ahead to new opportunities, and to express my sincere thanks to your outstanding contribution and teamwork. This year's theme, stability, sustainability, and inclusivity for shared prosperity, is not only fitting but also uniting, given the common challenges many of our countries are experiencing on the back of COVID-19 pandemic and global uncertainties. For countries like Fiji, where tourism is the backbone of the economy, the implications of the crisis was massive. While the economy has picked up, the higher global inflationary environment poses challenges on the cost of living front, particularly for the most vulnerable segments of our population. Similarly, in many advanced and emerging economies, the impact of COVID-19 crisis has led to greater inequalities, now at the highest level in 30 years and widening further. Amidst the rapid changes in global financial conditions and associated risks to the global outlook, appropriate fiscal and monetary measures combined with effective development strategies are needed to ensure global economic and financial stability. This means that our countries must continue to enhance and recalibrate our financial inclusion policies, which can contribute to domestic, regional, and global stability. But stability alone is not enough. We must also promote sustainability that ensures the prosperity we seek today does not come at the expense of future generations. It means safeguarding our environment, conserving our natural resources, mitigating the impacts of climate change, and ensuring that our girls, women, youths, and persons with disabilities are not left behind. When we commit to sustainability, we pledge to live a healthier, cleaner, and a more resilient world than the one we inherited. I am of the very strong view that prosperity should not be the privilege of a few, and I repeat, I'm of the very strong view that prosperity should not be the privilege of a few, but for all of us. Inclusivity means breaking down barriers of discrimination, inequality, and exclusion. It means providing equal opportunities for education, employment, and participation in the decision-making process. Inclusivity celebrates diversity and recognizes that our differences are our strengths. When we embrace inclusivity, we create a society where everyone can contribute and benefit from a shared prosperity. Reinforcing these three pillars of stability, sustainability, and inclusivity is therefore vital. When we ensure stability, we create an environment where businesses can thrive, jobs can be created, and individuals can confidently plan for the future. When we prioritize sustainability, we protect the resources that underpin our prosperity and prevent the devastation that unchecked exploitation can bring. And when we champion inclusivity, we tap into the full potential of our diverse society, unlocking innovation, creativity, and economic growth. Ladies and gentlemen, achieving stability, sustainability, and inclusivity for shared prosperity requires a collective effort, determination, and a commitment to the common good. It requires us to make difficult choices and sometimes forego immediate gains for the sake of a better tomorrow. It calls upon us to collaborate, innovate, and leave no one behind in our pursuit for prosperity. As we embark on this journey, let us keep in mind that both a destination and a continuous process. Let us hold ourselves accountable to our choices today and the impact on the world we leave for our future generations. I wish to highlight three important underpinnings for the success of our partnership and collaboration at AFI. Firstly, the strategic positioning of AFI as a network for emerging and developing countries is a testament to its pivotal role in shaping global financial landscape. AFI's unique positioning at the intersection of economic development and financial inclusion empowers emerging and developing nations to navigate the complexities of the modern financial world effectively. AFI's strategic positioning also leverages the collective strength of a diverse membership. Furthermore, AFI's network allows these nations to tap into the experience and expertise of their peers, enabling tailored solutions that reflect local realities while aligning with global standards. This inclusivity ensures no country is left behind, and solutions are contextually relevant. The strategically positioning of AFI as a network for emerging and developing countries is a testament to the commitment to fostering financial inclusion, stability, and prosperity in the world's most vulnerable and underserved region. AFI empowers its members to chart their path towards a more inclusive and equitable financial landscape through knowledge sharing, capacity building, and advocacy. As we look to the future, AFI's role as a catalyst for positioning change in emerging and developing countries remain indispensable. Secondly, maintaining and growing the membership of AFI is a paramount priority. AFI recognizes that its strength lies in the diversity of its members, member countries, and the collective expertise they bring to the table. By continuously engaging with existing members and actively seeking partnership, AFI ensures its relevance and enriches the network with fresh perspective and innovative ideas. This commitment to expanding its reach underscores AFI's dedication to advancing financial inclusion and stability worldwide. Through a dynamic and inclusive membership strategy, AFI remains steadfast in its efforts to catalyze positive changes in the global financial landscape. Thirdly, the value of good partnership cannot be overstated, and when it comes to supporting work and programs on financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is a complex and multifaceted goal that requires a concerted effort from various stakeholders, including government, financial institutions, civil society organizations, and international bodies. This collaborative partnership fosters innovation, promotes knowledge exchange, and leverages the strength of each partner to address the unique challenges of expanding financial access to the underserved population. Such partnership can help scale up successful models and share best practices, accelerating progress towards global financial inclusion goals. In essence, good partnerships are valuable and essential for creating a more inclusive and equitable financial ecosystem for all. In conclusion, financial inclusion is not just a policy goal. It's a fundamental human right and a powerful driver of economic growth and social equity. It is the key to unlocking the potential for billions of people around the world who have been excluded from the formal financial system. As we strive for a future where everyone has access to financial tools and services they need to build a better life, let us remember that financial inclusion is not a one-size-fits-all solution. It requires tailored approaches considering local context, diverse needs, and innovative solutions. It demands collaboration and partnership, the removal of barriers, and promotion of financial literacy. It is a journey that we must undertake together with unwavering commitment to ensure that no one is left behind. Let us continue our collective efforts to build a more inclusive and prosperous world where financial inclusion is not just a dream, but a reality. Coming from a very small, developing and vulnerable country, the challenges of financial inclusion are all very real for us. But I'm confident that with the expertise, dedication and leadership of the AFI board, supported by central banks of about 82 member countries of the network, we can overcome these challenges and achieve great success. I look forward to working with each and every one of you to make this financial inclusion vision a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Governor Ali, for setting the stage for the rich and meaningful discussions over the next 2 days and even beyond. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome Dr. Alfred Hannig, Executive Director of the Alliance for Financial Inclusion.
Secretary Gatchalian, Dr. Zeti, former Governor Bank Negara, Malaysia, and now the founding chair of the Asia School of Business, Dr. Eli Remolona, Governor of the BSP, Ariff Ali, Governor Reserve Bank of Fiji, our chair, dear board members of AFI, Honorable Benjamin Diokno, Finance Secretary, Deputy Governor Berna, Remolon, Bruce Tolentino, member of the board of the Bangko Sentral de Pilipinas, Ani Aquino, member of the board of the BSP, honorable ministers, governors, presidentes, superintendentes, deputy governors, all the central bank leaders, AFI funding partners, private sector partners, knowledge partners, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, please, let us in this moment of joy, which I think this is going to be for the next couple of days, let us also not forget about those who are currently struggling and mourning about those ones who have lost their lives. So I would like to share with me a moment of silence for the victims of the terrible catastrophe in Morocco. And I have actually written a letter to Governor Al-Johari and sent the condolences on behalf of our network and also mentioned to him that we will have this moment of silence, please. Please. Thank you very much. Please take your seats. As I said, this now is a very joyful moment. I'm referring to the last year when this gong was carried away by Deputy Governor Berna Remolon from the Dead Sea in Jordan to the Philippines. And you know, my feeling when I witnessed this very moment was actually that AFI is coming home. And this, I mean, in a very real and meaningful sense, AFI is coming home because, you know, Governor Dr. Ely has already elaborated on the history, and so has our chair. So let me also speak a little bit about the past. There was a conference hosted by Bank Indonesia in 2008 in Bali, when I actually met with Nestor Espinilla and another colleague, Pia, at that time called Pia Roman, to discuss the AFI idea, and I was surprised how enthusiastically these two bought into the concept. They just said, count us in. Now, BSP first was first official member of AFI in 2009. And I would like to share a picture with you. This is a picture that actually, you know, is an old picture, and I got it from a person who is also on this picture, my former co-director, Sunga Ali. She is there next to the lady from Kenya in blue. Pia, who hasn't changed at all, is also on this picture. And of course, Nestor is there. And this is the first, very first steering committee meeting of the Alliance for Financial Inclusion that took place on 10 July 2009 in Bangkok. We had other founding members present there, Mexico, and also Thailand, at that time represented by Governor Teresa Vatanagase. So this was the first crew who actually came together. And what was very important at this meeting, and I think I have mentioned it to you before, we already decided in the first meeting in 2009 that we would go to the third global policy forum that would take place in 2011 to ask the membership then, which was actually about to grow, to decide on becoming an independent organization. This was the origin. Now, when AFI was founded 15 years ago, one of the guiding lights, as I said, of our organization was Governor Nestor Espinilla, and he was a champion of financial inclusion. He was also an inspiration, and he also protected us. His vision, passion, commitment was critical to helping AFI to develop into this network. And I know that he always hoped, yeah, that one day the AFI Global Policy Forum would come to the Philippines. I know how proud and happy he would be to see you all. Now we can just say, we did it, Nestor. Governor Remolona has actually already given us a good overview of the history. Now, I mean, in a country comprising, you know, in, we are talking about early 2000s, in a country comprising of around 7,600 islands, traditional banking infrastructure left many Filipinos with limited access to financial services. And in this context, mobile payments, I think at that time we called it mobile financial services, emerged as a practical option for the unbanked to connect with financial infrastructure. And indeed, the country became a global pioneer, signifying its early entry into the world of digital payments. Services like GCash, smart money, transformed the accessibility of financial products for millions of Filipinos, making transactions more convenient and affordable. And it was next to Kenya and to a certain extent South Africa at the time, one of the early front runners on financial services adoption. And of course, we at the emerging AFI, we became very interested in the Philippines. We were looking at what was happening here, and we felt it is very important to share the early experience and knowledge from the Philippines. Also, the way at a very early stage the Philippines practiced, as Governor already elaborated, the test and learn approach, which is an early version of what people now talk about in a more sophisticated, organized way as a regulatory sandbox. Now, Philippines has become an important source of knowledge, but I think it has also become a consumer of knowledge. So I think we had two-way exchanges, and the BSP became one of the most active members in the whole AFI network. And that is also why we feel that AFI is coming home, because so many things that we have done have been done successfully together with the BSP. I believe indeed that AFI would not be there where we are without the BSP's support and engagement. Now, the story of the Philippines is also a reflection of AFI's journey. In many ways, the growth and the evolution of the financial inclusion really mirrors also what happened globally. Back in 2008, you will still remember, the concept of financial inclusion was understood very narrowly, or not at all. We focused predominantly on expanding access. 15 years later down the road, we have shown that financial inclusion is interlinked not only with vital issues related to gender, climate change, youth, entrepreneurship, data, technology, disabled people, forcibly displaced persons, and much more. We have also really put the focus towards sustainable and financial services usage and quality. And indeed, it is very positive to see that the perspective starting from 2009, when we actually met for the first Global Policy Forum, with just 176, 186 people in Kenya, with just 38 member institutions, since then we witnessed the consolidation towards a transition of AFI into an independent organization with today 85 members that now stands for financial inclusion all over the world. And today in this forum, after having 186 in Kenya, we are now counting more than 700 people. And it is a wonderful coincidence, talking about history, that the BSP invited Dr. Zeti to be with us today, because without Dr. Zeti, who spearheaded the submission of the Malaysian proposal to become the host country of the headquarter of the newly independent organization of AFI in 2016, was also very instrumental to bring this organization to success. Thank you, Dr. Zeti. Now, as Governor elaborated, the pandemic gave us a next push, and especially triggered mobile money from 2009 to 2016, we have seen progress. But with the digital transformation, with an accelerated pace as a consequence of the pandemic, there was much more to happen, and I think we all can see that in the countries we are working with. Now, despite all the progress that we have seen, remember in 2009 we talked about roughly about 3.2 billion people who were unbanked, but that was based on a very shallow database. Later on we had the Global Findex, and we were much more sure about the numbers we were talking about, but we have come down to 1.4 since then, so it's a great achievement. But despite all this progress, there are noticeable opportunities still out there, especially in different regions, to enable more equitable financial inclusion. And even on the digital adoption, there are persistent differences between regions, and we also know that many of you are struggling with risks of technology. Now, as the world has actually just moved out of one crisis, the health crisis, we are now facing another unique set of risks. And for example, IMF and others have warned about, you know, of the geopolitical fragmentation, which threatens both economic growth and trade, as well as international cooperation more broadly. And we have seen international organizations to collapse in trust, in terms of trust, because they are struggling to reach consensus positions amidst political divisions. Now, other risks are different. We know they are newer to us, we are less familiar to them. Climate change, biodiversity loss, and now ultimately the resurgence of price inflation. In view of all this, I want to urge you, and we will talk about this today, that we maintain our focus on financial inclusion, actually to demonstrate that stability objectives and financial inclusion are complementary rather than competing objectives. Now, I think we need to make sure that the message on financial inclusion stays high on the agenda, it becomes reinforced, and there are good reasons for us to do so. And the theme that we are actually having at this GPF is a nice reflection, not only of this focus that we should maintain, but also, again, of the history that we have been going through. This year's theme, from our point of view, is very, very relevant. And when you look at the theme that we have at today's GPF, it will come up now. There you see, it is actually very interesting where we are coming from. When we started off in Kenya 2009, the theme was bringing smart policies to life. It was a very handy, very crisp, very simple theme. But nowadays, you see it has become more complex, and it is really reflecting contemporary challenges but also opportunities. And I think Governor Ariff has already elaborated on how actually prosperity is the final result we are looking for, looking at all these other pillars that we are dealing with during this GPF. We therefore believe that this theme is a reflection on where we are within our journey and the response to the challenges of today. Now, at this GPF, we will also adopt the Manila Manifesto. This builds on positive developments we have seen in the strengths of AFI's engagements with the standard-setting bodies, maintaining and enhancing our relationships with the FATF, its regional bodies, with IARDI, the FSB, CPMI, and the BCBS. But let me reiterate before I come to the closing. Financial inclusion is an ongoing obligation, because we all know that even full inclusion does not mean that we can let go of our efforts in ensuring high quality and sustainable financial inclusion. And it is really encouraging to see that this lesson is now also being followed and incorporated by advanced economy regulators who have started mutual knowledge exchange with our network. It is very clear that maintaining a high level of financial inclusion is in everyone's interest, not just in the interest of the developing world. I would like to thank Governor of BSP, Dr. Ely Remolona. I would like to thank DG Berner Romelon for the organization taking lead in bringing everybody here, the very personal approach to this organization, your motivation to share the culture of the Philippines with us. I would like to thank the whole team on the BSP side. I haven't heard a single complaint about your organizational efforts. It is fantastic what you're doing for us. I would like to thank all the members who are in the room, who have come from far to join in these very important discussions. I would like to thank our public-private dialogue partners to be here, our funding partners, the stakeholders, the partners in the wider financial inclusion ecosystem, and of course, also all helping hands behind the scenes who helped to make this event successful. My last point is actually that the journey continues. Yeah? And as we have said, we have a couple of four members. We have a couple of new members, four of them. You see them there from the Comoros, from Zimbabwe, from Central Africa. And also from Senegal, we have a couple of membership upgrades from Dominican Republic and Honduras, and we also have a new observer to AFI, which is the government of Luxembourg, also represented here. Let me just end by saying I do believe that by working together, by collaborating across borders, by thinking outside the box and continuing to think outside the box, we will find solutions. The AFI network, as we have seen, does all these things exceptionally well. And I can only say we can be very optimistic about the contribution AFI can make to delivering on both stability and sustainable development, and to meeting not just the challenges of today, but especially the challenges of tomorrow. And when I say the journey continues, I mean the journey continues from right here, where we are hosted by those ones who were with us from the beginning. Welcome to all of you. Thank you.
And we thank you, Dr. Hannig, for those very kind words. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my esteemed pleasure to invite our keynote speaker. Please put your hands together for the former governor of Bank Negara, Malaysia, and founding chair of the Asia School of Business, Dr. Zeti Aziz.
respectfully honorable distinguished guests and dear friends of the AFI financial inclusion community. Stability and sustainability are important foundations for achieving a greater inclusion and a greater shared prosperity. Significant developments experienced in the recent global environment have, however, resulted in rising income inequalities, not just in the emerging and developing economies, but also in some parts of the developed world. The effects of the global health pandemic, the intensification of the greater leverage on digitalization and technology, as well as the sharply rising inflation, which has eroded the purchasing power for especially the lower income groups, have cumulatively contributed to this trend. The financial inclusion agenda, therefore, never has been more pressing and urgent. It is my great honor to be invited here today to speak at this AFI Global Forum 2023 in this magnificent city of Manila. The Alliance for Financial Inclusion can take great pride in its contribution to advancing the global efforts in driving the financial inclusion agenda. Most significant are the efforts that have galvanized the world to come together to work collectively towards achieving more inclusive financial systems in our dynamic global environment. The Alliance for Financial Inclusion has also surfaced leading-edge constructive ideas on how this inclusion agenda might be achieved. AFI has evolved a global community that has propelled with great energy the advancement of financial inclusion, bringing together all the stakeholders from policymakers to representatives of the private sector from all parts of the world to be aligned to achieve the common goal of financial inclusion. While we can be gratified with the progress made in this financial inclusion space, the expectations now have, however, been elevated with increased demands for achieving a greater shared prosperity. Our aspirations now are to achieve a dramatically transformative difference. In essence, we should not be satisfied with incremental improvements, but need to work and to intensify our efforts towards achieving a transformational achievement for the financial inclusion agenda. Pivotal to achieving such a transformational achievement is essentially about having the required ecosystem that will indeed spearhead such a breakthrough shift in our financial systems, which would in turn bring about a sustainable shared prosperity. The word ecosystem was actually first coined by an English botanist in 1935, used to refer to a biological community of interacting organisms and their environment. It is currently now being used more generally to refer to a complex interconnected system. It is this ecosystem that is needed for bringing about transformative progress in the financial inclusion agenda and thus bring about a stable, sustainable, and shared prosperity. My remarks this morning will focus on the building of such an ecosystem. While the component separate parts may be well known, it is, however, their interconnectivity, interdependence, and integration that needs to occur so that the separate parts will become mutually reinforcing and thus create the potential for transformative progress. While digital technology has been known to bring about such transformative upliftment in the financial inclusion space, it will still, however, need to operate in the supporting ecosystem to enhance its potential viability and sustainability. Allow me to briefly highlight the seven elements that are vital to the ecosystem. The first relates to the financial infrastructure that which will facilitate financial inclusion, that is a financial system that is safe, efficient, and accessible. This would essentially comprise the range of financial institutions and the payment system. It would also include a sound legal infrastructure that covers the legal aspects to ensure certainty in executions and enforcement. Equally important is having clarity on the financial inclusion mandate. And in Malaysia, in the Central Bank Act that we rewrote in 2009, the financial inclusion mandate was made explicit. The mandate being stated as the development of an inclusive financial system. This was to ensure that future generations of the central bank would continue to accord importance to the financial inclusion agenda. The second element vital to the ecosystem relates to the product offerings, the types of the financial products and services that would meet the requirements of savers and borrowers, particularly for the lower income groups and small businesses. Financial innovation and the advent of digitalization has indeed increased the potential for their effective usage, improving the relative affordability and their greater outreach. Other important considerations are increased convenience and security. The third element relates to the financial consumer protection, which ensures that the treatment of financial consumers will be responsible and fair. In essence, it refers to financial well-being of consumers arising from their participation in the financial system. This is about bringing consumer trust and confidence in the financial system. Financial consumers also need to have awareness of their rights so as to reduce the prospect of being subject to fraudulent practices. Equally important for consumers is to have awareness of their responsibilities and accountabilities and to be well positioned to make informed financial decisions. Related to this is to have the platform for addressing grievances and dispute resolution on financial matters. Related to this, and it has been mentioned, is the fourth vital element in the ecosystem, the financial literacy, to ensure that the participation in the financial mainstream will not only be effective, but also bring benefit to their economic well-being. Indeed, these need to focus on the entire life cycle of the individual, from their early childhood to their working life and into their retirement. Their effective participation will also contribute to the more efficient functioning of the financial system and would increase the potential for the economy to prosper. However, given the highly dynamic financial and economic environment, the drive for financial literacy will always be and unfinished business. It is a shared responsibility among all the financial services provider, central bank, regulators, government, ministries, and agencies, in addition to the corporate and non-governmental organizations. The aim is to continually equip the respective communities with the necessary financial skills and confidence to effectively manage their personal finances and businesses. The fifth vital element in the ecosystem is the financial regulatory framework and supervisory oversight. The challenge here has always been to balance between the goals of financial inclusion and that of ensuring financial stability. While there has been a consensus on adopting a more proportionate approach where the regulation applied is commensurate with the risks, benefit, and costs, the issue of this effective is the effective application in practice. It remains challenging. In particular, whether its application would indeed affect the access to finance by the low-income households and small businesses. Similarly, the supervisory oversight over microfinancial institutions will also need to be commensurate with the inherent risks and costs. Different institutional arrangements with a more risk-based supervision and different disclosure requirements would need to be developed. The next part of the ecosystem is that for addressing financial distress and resolution, and this is often very much neglected. This has traditionally focused on impaired and distressed financial institutions. Equally important, however, are the mechanisms and schemes that need to address the situation of the users, and this is always forgotten, in particular for the households and the lower income groups, as well as for small businesses. This would avoid widespread foreclosures, bankrupts, and bankruptcies within this segment. And we all saw this happen in for the middle and lower income groups during the subprime crisis. Such mechanisms would involve debt restructuring arrangements for the households and for the small businesses, as well as funding schemes, credit guarantee facilities, and special funds to provide support during challenging times. Aside from these mechanisms, cash transfers have also been part of the social safety net for this segment. The seventh element in the ecosystem to support the financial inclusion agenda is the development of professionals that are needed to build and execute the necessary outcomes of this ecosystem. Sufficiently well-trained finance professionals are essential for the performance of the financial sector, given the rapidly changing financial industry. Practitioners of the financial services sector need to be highly qualified and equipped with the capability, technical caliber, and knowledge. Equally important is the human capital development in the public sector, not only in the areas of finance, but also in the areas of governance, leadership, and sustainability. Given the extensive and decentralized number of entities in the ecosystem, the integration and synthesis of all its component parts to form a connected whole will be essential to deliver the transformative outcome. Additionally, there are new channels through which risks are also being transmitted. There's also the increased role of the global dimension. Imperative in this environment is the need for greater coordination to ensure consistency of the outcomes. The management of the financial inclusion agenda is therefore not confined to the remit of a single authority or that of an individual country, but it calls for the collective efforts by multiple agencies within a country and across countries. The key feature in the design of the governance arrangements within such an ecosystem calls for greater effective coordination and collaboration. There essentially needs to be an effective interface between the relevant agencies within government and with the private sector. Such an arrangement will need to define clear boundaries. It involves boundary management to the highest degree to provide clarity on the areas of responsibility and accountability. Given the complex mix of policies, efforts, having their respective expected outcomes and accountabilities clearly defined will ensure the alignment of the multiple actions required to achieve the ultimate goals of the financial inclusion agenda. This will ensure that all stakeholders in the ecosystem will collectively power forward the shared vision for financial inclusion. Frequently, a collegial governance structure involving a high-level council or committee, which I think you have already here in the Philippines, has been adopted to translate the financial inclusion mandate into a governance and accountability framework. The arrangement would then represent a coordination platform or vehicle comprising the different respective multiple entities. Such a vehicle would also facilitate the support and buy-in needed from the various diverse groupings to evolve a common shared vision and to collectively deliver the breakthrough outcomes. Important to this process is the leadership that brings the component parts together. In an orchestra, it is the conductor that unifies the performers, that sets the tempo and the beat, that shapes the sounds of the music. It is the conductor that will command the power of the ensemble to bring about a deep connection with the musicians and the audience. In the same way, it is the leadership in the financial inclusion ecosystem that will bring together all the component parts to deliver a transformative financial inclusion outcome. So the message here is essentially that it is the entire financial inclusion ecosystem that needs to be built and a strong leadership that will make the difference in powering forward the financial inclusion agenda and hence the shared prosperity that is being aspired. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zeti Aziz. It is indeed our privilege that you have accepted our invitation to be the guest speaker at these opening ceremonies. It is now with great honor and privilege, ladies and gentlemen, to have our ceremonies this morning officiated by the head of one of the founding members of the Financial Inclusion Steering Committee, which is the interagency body overseeing the implementation of the Philippine National Strategy for Financial Inclusion. Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of the Department of Social Welfare and Development, Honorable Rex Gatchalian.
Good morning, Governor Eli Remolona, Thank you for the invitation, of course, Secretary Benjamin Jokno. Morning, sir. Distinguished participants of the member institutions of the Alliance for Financial Inclusion, AFI, fellow financial inclusion champions and advocates, ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant morning. I am deeply honored by the invitation to address you today in this year's Global Policy Forum, where we come together under the theme of sustainability, and inclusivity for shared prosperity. I acknowledge the effort of the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas in bringing to Manila this important gathering of AFI, the world's leading organization on financial inclusion policy and regulation. On a personal note, I do understand that a lot of you are first-timers in the city. I hope everybody is having a great time in Manila. While I do not come from the ranks of distinguished bankers, as most delegates here are, we do share the same goal in everything we do on a daily basis: serve the public in different capacities. I've been in the public service realm for quite some time, having served as a member of Congress for 6 years and a local chief executive for 9 years. I was serving again as a member of Congress since last year, until I was called by President Ferdinand R. Marcos Jr. to join his cabinet around 7 months ago as Secretary of the Department of Social Welfare and Development. As I share my experience and life lessons in public service, it comes with the realization that the path to financial inclusion and shared prosperity is a multifaceted journey that requires dedication, innovation, and collaboration. But before I go into the details of where we want to take our clients in the department in terms of financial literacy and inclusion, I cannot skip the chapter in my life where I served as local chief executive, as a city mayor in one of the cities of Metro Manila. See, they always say that life experiences gives you a different lens on the directions that you will take in the future. So the directions that we will take in the department is honed from my experience as a local chief executive for 9 years in the city of Valenzuela. See, as mayor, you see the world of poverty in a micro perspective. While in the national setting, I realized in the past 7 months, we talk about poverty in terms of numbers and statistics. But serving as city mayor in my past life taught me that poverty has a face, has a name, and they have a family to talk about. When you're a city mayor, you see micro things and you see micro poverty from a micro lens. You actually see the actual faces of missed opportunities to bring people out of poverty just because they are, one, financially illiterate, and two, they are financially excluded. The World Bank was correct in saying that the financial literacy and financial inclusion are the key enablers of the SDGs. And case in point, in Valenzuela City, when I was city mayor, doing development work and trying to formalize informal settler encampments, we did see vast missed opportunities where slum areas could have turned into formal housing just because the organization that wanted to join the public bid to own that piece of land did not materialize because, one, they did not have a bank account to begin with, and two, they were too scared to actually be banked. See, in the city of Valenzuela, just like most urban settings, one of the biggest problems of urban decay will be slum areas. And in our thrust to formalize them, we actually worked into public auctions, auctioning the lands where they actually live in so that they become secured and they would become land tenured. But the sad part about this, in engaging them in these public auctions, the organizations, the community organizations, couldn't participate because, like I said, they didn't have a basic checking account to begin with. And when asked if any of their members would have a checking account so that they can act in the stead of the organization, sadly, close to 1,000 members would say not a single member had a bank account to begin with. Again, looking into those missed opportunities, we could have formalized them and we could have turned their slum areas into sustainable communities, but the very first step of owning land and joining a public bid to own the piece of land where they were living in didn't materialize because, again, they were financially excluded, and they were financially illiterate. When I say financially illiterate, I call that the sister of financial inclusion, making sure that they are responsible in their banking habits, making sure that they have a strong sense of setting up savings accounts. But in the sad reality is, in both cases, I cannot overemphasize the missed opportunity in pulling them out of poverty or taking the first step of pulling them out of poverty through land security because they were financially excluded and they were financially illiterate. Now, towards the closing part of my 9-year run as city mayor, right before I was termed out, COVID happened. And the second incidence of poverty staring me right in front of my face because of financial exclusion took place. During that time, the government launched one of the world's largest social amelioration program. The goal then during those lockdown times where people were made to stay at home was to bridge through cash grants the poorest of the poor families. In the case of Valenzuela City, the city where I served in, we were targeting close to 200,000 families. 200,000 families that would get cash grants from the national government at a wave of 3 times, at the start of the COVID pandemic, in the middle of it, and towards the latter part. The sad part about that part, that time was, we were sending mixed signals. We were telling people to stay at home and social distance, but at the same time, we were telling them to come to the payout centers, fall in line to get their cash grants. There lies the irony of things. Local governments were telling them, stay at home, social distance, do unnecessary trips outside the house, but because they were financially excluded and they did not have bank accounts to begin with, or they were not part of any digital banking institution, they had to troop all the way out of their homes, go into cramped payout centers, fall in line for half a day, and try to get their cash grants. So sadly, those experiences taught me that a vast swath of our poor, marginalized, vulnerable sector are actually not only financially illiterate, but are also financially excluded. These experiences during my stint as city mayor drove me to introduce innovative ways to provide the people, especially those that have less in life, effective access to finance-related products and services to address their state of helplessness, to enhance their ability to meet financial obligations, recover from financial shocks, and develop a sense of control over their finances. I stand in front of you today as the Secretary of Social Welfare and Development, or DSWD, the agency in the Philippine government which has the mandate to lead in the formulation, implementation, and coordination of social protection programs for the poor, marginalized, and disadvantaged sectors of the society. At first glance, the impression is that we serve the sectors which are primarily financially excluded as they belong to the underserved and unserved segments of the population by reason of their status in life. We refer to those lower income classes, indigent senior citizens, persons with disabilities, indigenous peoples, and others who are excluded due to their vulnerable and marginalized status. No doubt, financial exclusion exists. The Philippine government is addressing this. The cornerstone of our commitment on this is the National Strategy for Financial Inclusion 2022 to 2028. In 2016, the Philippine President issued Executive Order Number 208, Institutionalizing Financial Inclusion Steering Committee, the FISC, as a governing body, provides the strategic direction, guidance, and oversight in the implementation of the National Strategy for Financial Inclusion. This strategic framework lays out a roadmap for empowering the vulnerable sectors of our society. At its core, it embodies the belief that stability and sustainability cannot be achieved without inclusivity. And it is through financial inclusion that we can truly foster shared prosperity. For this forum, allow me to speak about the 3 most important programs of our department and the strategies we adopted to achieve modest accomplishments in terms of promotion of financial inclusion and financial resilience. First is the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program, which we call 4Ps. This is the National Flagship Poverty Reduction Strategy and Human Capital Investment Program of the Philippines. As one of our flagship programs, the 4Ps program stands as a beacon of financial inclusion. Through the initiative, we provide conditional cash transfers to around 4.4 million poor households for a maximum period of 7 years to improve health, nutrition, and educational aspects of their lives. In line with our commitment to innovation and efficiency, we have taken significant steps to enhance digital payment adoption with the 4Ps program. In partnership with the Land Bank of the Philippines, we have converted 100% of the cash cards of the 4Ps beneficiaries to transactional accounts. This allows 4Ps households to directly use the account to deposit savings, receive funds, and enjoy other financial inclusion enhancing features, thereby making the account a valuable tool in the development of financial skills and in the improvement of household well-being and self-reliance. Financial literacy and resilience are pivotal components of our financial inclusion strategy. We understand that it is not enough to provide financial assistance. We must also equip vulnerable communities with the knowledge and skills they need to make informed financial decisions and withstand economic shocks. Thus, modules on financial literacy are also incorporated in the topics being discussed during the regular family development sessions to assist head of households in managing their finances. During its rollout in December 2021, which continued in the entirety of 2022, the four modules provided an array of discussions on budgeting, savings, and transaction accounts. Sessions even led to more advanced modules of expanding livelihood through entrepreneurship, microinsurance, and microcredit. Currently, the financial literacy manual has been aligned with the family development session 7-year transformational learning path. Another program is the assistance to individuals in crisis situation, which is intended to provide financial and material assistance to vulnerable and marginalized individuals and families needing immediate intervention to access basic services. It serves as a society safety net or stopgap measure to provide recovery of individuals and families suffering from unexpected life events or crisis. On a yearly basis, especially as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, we served around 3.6 to 5.3 million beneficiaries nationwide annually. With this volume of clients, we have piloted the design of the government-to-person infrastructure, or G2P infrastructure, that integrates the national foundational ID in the intake, case assessment, and the digital payment of beneficiaries or to accredit hospitals for medical assistance. Once we have addressed some of the legal framework and accountability issues, we hope to implement a contactless, fully digital disbursement to qualified beneficiaries. By digitalizing cash transfers, which is the use of beneficiary banks or e-money account in the transfer of assistance, beneficiaries will find account ownership useful and compelling. This would also address the need to have multiple paymasters and special disbursing officers, which affect the simultaneous implementation of DSWD's programs due to the need to augment manpower to complement physical and manual payouts. The newest program that we have is the food stamp program. Now, just to give you a bird's eye view of the food stamp program, the food stamp program aims to give food credits to 1 million Filipino families that are rated as food poor families. These are the poorest of the poor segments that we are referring to. These 1 million food poor families do not make more than 8,000 pesos monthly to be able to buy enough nutritional values to put on their table. The concept here is to not use the traditional food vouchers, but rather to use digital mechanisms and to give each family an electronic benefit transfer card. The electronic benefit transfer card will be loaded monthly with a 3,000 food credit supplement, not in cash, but rather food credits. Now, one may wonder, how does this fall into the greater scheme of financial inclusion? We would like to look at this lens as the food stamps program and its electronic beneficiary transfer cards as a startup kit of sorts, teaching our poorest of the poor how to use digital platforms in accessing benefits. We want to make sure that we break the mindset that it's scary to go digital and it is scary to be banked. Hopefully, by the time that we're done with the food stamps program, our beneficiaries would gain the confidence of using digital platforms in trying to access their basic cash grants. Again, we would like to look at the food stamps program's digital platform as a startup kit, trying to create paradigm shifts and break mindsets that our poorest of the poor do not know how to use digital formats or should be unbanked. The food stamps program is in its pilot stage, and we plan to scale it up to 300,000 families, thereafter a million Filipino food poor families in a couple of years. Families are the main thrust of the program is to once and for all end hunger, end involuntary hunger, and help our pregnant and lactating women cope with the necessary nutritional values that they need. But consequently, it will also enhance their ability to use digital formats in terms of accessing basic assistance from the national government. In the heart of our financial inclusion journey, one principle guides us unwaveringly: the commitment to ensure that no one is left behind. Our shared prosperity agenda isn't a catchphrase. It is the very essence that fuels our every action. We hold a profound belief that in the fruits of economic growth, must reach every citizen. With particular attention to the most vulnerable members of our society, it means that our pursuit of financial inclusion, we view inclusivity as not just an option, but as an imperative. It is an understanding that a society's true strength lies in how it uplifts its most marginalized and vulnerable members. It's a commitment to bridge the gap between the privileged and disadvantaged, ensuring that the benefits of prosperity are accessible to all. For a social welfare agency, we are aware that financial inclusion is not merely about increasing the number of bank accounts or digital transactions. It's about empowering individuals and communities through continuous and sustained capacity building, providing them with the tools to break free from the cycle of poverty, enabling them to secure a better future for themselves and their families. Our shared prosperity agenda is a call to action, a challenge to innovate, and a commitment to break down barriers. It means ensuring that a single mother in a remote village has the same access to financial services as a business owner in a bustling city. It means equipping the elderly with the knowledge to manage their pensions wisely. It means helping vulnerable communities build resilience against economic shocks. We understand that achieving this vision is a complex task that requires dedication, collaboration, and continuous adaptation. It's about building bridges, digital, and metaphorical, connecting those that have been left on the outskirts of the financial system. It's about crafting policies that are inclusive by design, ensuring that the most marginalized are at the front and center of our efforts. Our journey towards financial inclusion and shared prosperity is not a solidarity endeavor. The DSWD is thankful to the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas as it leads the Financial Inclusion Steering Committee and ensures effective progress monitoring of financial inclusion activities that will facilitate evidence-based policymaking that will ultimately improve the lives of the poor. Financial inclusion is a collective mission that requires the active participation of governments, financial institutions, civil society, and international organizations. It's about recognizing that the fight against poverty and inequality is not one that can be won alone, but one that demands unity and cooperation. The path ahead may have challenges, and the roads to financial inclusion may be winding, but our commitment remains steadfast. Our actions, policies, and initiatives are all geared towards a future where sustainable, stable, and inclusivity are not just aspirations, but the very fabric of our society. It is a future where no one is left behind, and every citizen can share in the prosperity that is rightfully theirs. We will definitely not stop here as we aim to build on milestones and lessons learned and cultivate new achievements for the improvement of our services to every Filipino family. Thank you for your attention. Let us continue this vital journey together, ensuring that no one is left behind as we march towards stability, sustainability, and inclusivity for shared prosperity. Mabuhay, maraming salamat, thank you all.
Thank you very much, our distinguished keynote speaker for the opening ceremonies, Honorable Rex Gatchalian. Thank you very much for sharing your perspectives and reminding us that every number, every statistic that we look at and study, we are looking, in fact, at the face that we, whose life we hope to change. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we at the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas are proud to present a special gift to AFI on this momentous occasion. Composed by the National Artist of the Philippines for Music, Mr. Ryan Kayabyab, this very special gift will be sung by our very own Bangko Sentral singers. Ladies and gentlemen, we present the AFI hymn. Time, AFI has a hymn that we can use for all eternity. As tradition would have it, we have one request of the Honorable Secretary Rex Gatchalian, and it is to officially open the 2023 AFI Global Policy Forum. We invite Secretary Gatchalian, together with our distinguished speakers, to come to the front and carry on with the tradition of opening the Global Policy Forum. Secretary Gatchalian, distinguished speakers, we invite you to ring the gong in 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2023 AFI Global Policy Forum is now officially open. We now take you to the beginnings where it all started, the official journey of the Philippine financial inclusion, in through this story. Thank you. And now, let us come together in a moment of reflection and unity to take part in a ritual anchored on the traditions of the Filipino people. Today, here at the 2023 Alliance for Financial Inclusion Global Policy Forum, we celebrate and offer seven of nature's and man's symbols to honor the enduring spirits of both our modern era and ancient times, praying for a productive and inspired gathering of financial inclusion champions. We offer fire, a symbol of our collective passion for improving lives. May this passion and strong sense of mission sustain us through the peaks and valleys of our financial inclusion journey. We offer water, a symbol of life, soothing, nurturing, and cleansing. May we have clarity of mind and steadfastness in our pursuit of our noble goal. For salt, a versatile mineral that is essential to life, as we are all called to be the salt of the earth, good and honest people striving to bring out the best in each of us. Bamboo, a symbol of resilience and regeneration. May we all remain hope-filled and inspired in our pursuit of stability, sustainability, and financial inclusion so that no one gets left behind. Finally, we offer various hand-woven textiles. May they symbolize each of our unique contributions coming together beautifully as a tapestry of dreams fulfilled. May it symbolize the unity of our desire for the best outcomes for the 2023 Alliance for Financial Inclusion Global Policy Forum. these we offer with faith and gratitude. High behind the clouds and kiss the sky. We welcome you to our beautiful country, with miles and miles of sand and sea. It beckons you to keep returning to a place that keeps you yearning, for a great adventure's burning in your heart and in your soul.
Islands, but no man, no Filipino, is an island. We have an internalized sense of connectedness as a people, bound by our shared belief in the power of community. We thrive as a people when we show up and be there for one another. This is the essence of Bayanihan. Bayanihan refers to the Filipino spirit of working together for a common good. It is usually represented by the coming together of citizens in creating or moving the bahay kubo, a symbol of home, of hope, and family. With everyone coming together, we see how financial inclusion entails a whole of nation effort guided by the Bayanihan spirit. For all Filipinos to one day live under one roof of prosperity. Financial inclusion in the Philippines is a journey marked by the hopes and ambitions of a nation. A road where the aspirations of its people pave the way toward a brighter, more inclusive future.
Gusto ko magkaroon ng sariling bayan at lupa.
Sana lalo pang lumago ang aking negosyo.
Pangarap kong matulungan at maitaas ang antas ng pamumuhay ng aking pamilya.
Pangarap ko pong makapag-provide para sa aking pamilya.
Pangarap kong maitaguyod ang aking mga anak para sa kanilang magandang kinabuhay.
Ang pangarap ko ay mapatapos ko yung mga anak ko kasi yun lang ang kayamanang maiiwan namin sa kanila.
I am also a product of generations of hardworking Filipinos, and I empathize deeply with your dreams and your ambitions. I know how important it is to save for the future and prepare for a rainy day. It truly makes me happy to observe more Filipinos now have access to financial services, helping them to achieve their aspirations. Indeed, we have gone a long way in our financial inclusion journey. Yet, the work continues.
Financial inclusion is a state wherein there is effective access to a wide range of financial services for all, especially the vulnerable sectors. Effective access does not only mean that there are financial products and services that are available. These products and services must be appropriately designed, of good quality, and responsive to the varied needs of individuals and businesses, whether for saving, payments, financing, investments, or insurance. Rather than being a mere end in itself, financial inclusion is a means to achieve broader aspirations. When people are financially included and realize their stake in national prosperity, they are empowered to make better, informed choices when it comes to their financial welfare and future. In turn, they are able to make sound decisions that raise their productivity and standard of living.
Ang pangarap ko po sa buhay, paglaki ko po, ay maging isang lawyer at maging public servant. At naniniwala ako na sa financial inclusion, dito natin makakamit yung pagkakaroon ng access sa financial services na meron tayo. Dahil dito, natututo tayo kung paano mag-ipon ng mas maaga. Kumbaga, tayo ay future ready dahil alam na natin kung paano gagastusin yung pera natin, paano natin gagamitin ng tama, at kung paano tayo makakapag-ipon. Dahil isa rin sa mga problema siguro sa Pilipinas ay yung kapag nag-iipon ang isang pamilyang Pilipino, hindi nila alam kung paano sila mag-iipon. Minsan, nag-iipon sila sa isang alkansya, sa mag-iipon sila sa wallet lang nila, sa bahay lang nila, na madalas nagagastos din nila. Kaya mahalaga na alam natin kung ano yung mga financial services din na pwede nating gamitin para makapag-ipon tayo. Actually, ang financial services na meron ako ngayon ay e-wallet. At nagagamit ko siya sa pang-araw-araw ko na pag-aaral. Lalong-lalo na sa tuwing ako ay pumapasok sa aking paaralan. At mahalaga ito dahil isa ito sa nakikita kong solusyon para makalaya tayo sa kahirapan na pinagdadaanan ng bawat isang normal na Pilipino.
The dream is to enjoy a stable and comfortable life. Secure in the knowledge that we have enough for our daily needs and unexpected expenses, so that we can plan and prepare for our own and children's future. This dream is anchored on the National Strategy for Financial Inclusion 2022 to 2028, launched in January 2022. The NSFI aims to ensure that the strategy remains a responsive and relevant blueprint for mobilizing the nation to accelerate financial inclusion and help lay the groundwork for sustainable and equitable national development. It is championed by the 21 Philippine government agencies that make up the Financial Inclusion Steering Committee. In ensuring that it is a whole of nation undertaking, and reflecting the indomitable spirit of Bayanihan, as all stakeholders work hand in hand toward the vision of inclusive growth and financial resilience for every Filipino.
As you see, we have a strategy, a roadmap to follow toward achieving the vision of resilience and inclusive growth for every Filipino. And as we continue on this journey, we look back at the eras that show the evolution of our agenda, from microfinance to financial inclusion for impact. We begin in the year 2000, when the BSP adopted microfinance as a poverty alleviation program. The advocacy began with a modest aim: to make small sums of money available as loans to the underprivileged, help them become productive, and improve their future.
By the early 2000s to 2011, microfinance was mainstreamed in the banking sector through regulations on housing, microfinance plus, microinsurance, and microagriculture finance.
So, para kanino nga ba ako bumabangon? Siyempre, of course, number one is para sa pamilya. And of course, number two is para kumita, hindi lang para sa sarili ko. And of course, para matulungan ang aking mga. Kasi number one priority din ni Cafe Amadeo ay tulungan yung mga farmers na taga dito sa bayan ng Amadeo. So noon, si Cafe Amadeo ay meron lang kaming fertilizer loan para sa mga farmers. Ngayon ay meron na kaming upcoming na productive loan, meron kaming providential loan. Lahat naman ay nag-uumpisa tayo sa baba. So magtiyaga para meron tayong makukuha. Noon naman ay sa isang lata ng kape ay marami ng bata ang makakapagtapos ng pag-aaral. Nagsimula lang sa isang coffee bean na iisa lang hanggang sa dumami na. Nagkaroon ng sanga, nagkaroon na ng mga dahon, nagkaroon na ng bunga. So yung mga bunga kami yon, yung mga empleyado, yung mga farmers. Sa tulong na rin ng mga pinansyal ng iba't ibang ahensya ay malaking bagay yung nakamtan ni Cafe Amadeo.
The advocacy on microfinance was continued by BSP Governor Amando M. Tetangco Jr., under whose term the microfinance unit was transformed into the Inclusive Finance Advocacy Staff, or the IFAS. With the creation of IFAS, the BSP was recognized as the first central bank in the world to establish a unit solely dedicated to financial inclusion. By 2008, the Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas joined the Alliance for Financial Inclusion, or AFI. The mainstreaming of microfinance in the banking sector paved the way for small credit to finance entrepreneurial activities. Microfinance thus became an empowerment tool for the entrepreneurial poor to pursue livelihoods and better their lives. Such a breakthrough was eventually recognized by the Economist Intelligence Unit in 2009, when it hailed the Philippines as first in the world in terms of regulatory framework for microfinance. In the next 4 years, the Philippines continued to rank first in Asia and remain consistently in the top five globally for having a favorable environment for financial inclusion.
In
Indeed, these reforms in financial policies and programs have given me and my fellow Filipinos hope for a better life. But our journey towards financial inclusion does not stop there. As we ride the wave of technological and digital innovations, our commitment to making financial services accessible remains unwavering. The Philippines is at the forefront of continuing financial inclusion journey, where digitalization is not just a tool, but a catalyst for progress. With financial services now literally at our fingertips, we are poised and ready for a more inclusive future.
Technology and innovation have played a big role in accelerating the advancement of financial inclusion. Mobile phones and digital innovations have expanded access to financial services by addressing geographical barriers and providing more efficient and cost-effective solutions to reach the unbanked. BSP is, in fact, the first central bank to issue a landmark regulation on electronic money in 2009, following its pioneering test and learn approach to promote innovation in financial inclusion.
Nagsimula po ang aming negosyo noong 2002. So, marami po kami tinutulungan ng mabaihan na walang trabaho. So, kung dati po is in cash, so ibabayad mo. So ngayon po, nagkakaroon po kami na pwede kaming kumuha sa kanila and then 1 month payment. And then the payment is online through banking. Malaking naitutulong ang digital form payments kasi ang aming mga supplier, lalo kung saan-saang lugar, mas accessible po sa atin ang pagbabayad ng mga through banking o kaya mga online na. Mas nakakagaan sa amin kasi dumami ang aming customer. Base po sa aking experience, ang pagdadala po ng cash o malaking amount, talagang hindi po safe. Kasi po, na-experience ko rin after po, nagkaroon po ako ng experience dito sa aking tindahan. So in seconds lang po, nagawa niya po yung kanyang hangarin na makuha po, makuha ang aking bitaka. Kung sa digital tayo, kung sa banking tayo, through online, so mas manapapamadali ang pagbabayad natin sa ating mga supplier na hindi tayo magkikerry ng anumang money, ng malaking money. So nakakaiwas kami sa mga fake money.
Sa pamamagitan no yun, o umangat po yung aming negosyo, nagkaroon po kami ng mas marami pa po kami natutulungan, lalo po sa aming mga community.
Financial safety for Filipinos remained a priority, hence the issuance of BSP regulations on financial consumer protection in 2014. In 2015, another milestone in the Philippines' financial inclusion journey emerged with the creation of the National Retail Payment System, or the NRPS. The NRPS eventually paved the way for the launch of the PesoNet and InstaPay. Through these two interoperable electronic fund transfer schemes, Filipinos only needed one BSP-regulated account, whether a bank or an e-money account, to conveniently send or receive funds. In 2017 to 2018, key policies on digital finance, such as regulation on cash agents and basic deposit account, were issued. These initiatives aim to democratize access to a transaction account as gateway to greater financial inclusion. Transaction accounts not only became more affordable and convenient, but also more useful and valuable, especially for the small value transactors.
Who knew it could be this easy to pay and receive money? I don't see how this could get any better. The BSP has been an early and steadfast advocate of financial inclusion. But it is not alone. I wonder who ensures that all these financial inclusion initiatives are aligned and well-coordinated to benefit all Filipinos.
Thank you.
Indeed, by working together, we can achieve a more inclusive society, leaving no one behind. And speaking of education and empowerment,
in line with financial inclusion efforts, financial and consumer protection initiatives were rolled out to empower consumers and ensure their effective and safe use of financial services. The partnership framework was introduced to scale the reach of financial literacy programs. Technology and social media were utilized to promote consumer protection and financial education tools to the digitally savvy. In addition, the passage of the Financial Consumer Protection Act provided much-needed, all-encompassing legal foundation for instilling market discipline and protecting financial consumers' rights in the country.
Here in Australia, everything closes at 5. So, usually, yung mga traditional na pinagpapadalahan na kailangan mong pumunta sa stores, so also, nag-close din sila ng 5. So, for me, it's hard na umabot sa ganung oras kasi I also work until 5 p.m. Pero nung ganamit ko tong app na to, kahit anong oras, pwede ako makapagpadala. Makikita mo rin kung how much yung each charge nila. Depende sa amount na ipapadala mo. And naka-breakdown yun lahat. So hindi ka mag-worry kung paano siya nag-work. Kahit anong oras, kahit nasan ako, pwede akong makapagpadala. And also, it saves my time. So, for me and for my family, important tong app na to kasi hindi lang siya convenient for me na nagpapadala. Convenient din to sa kanila. So, mas easy sa kanila yun kasi diretso na sa account nila.
It was an exciting journey so far, but then 2020 happened. With COVID-19, no one was spared. This challenging time tested our patience, tested our faith. In this situation, we only had each other to rely on.
says goodbye.
The past 3 years have been challenging for us, but we survived. We healed as one, and together we'll rebuild what was lost and carry on with our journey.
While the pandemic brought significant challenges, it also presented a silver lining as more Filipinos and businesses recognized the benefits of going digital, enabled by the foundational regulatory efforts years before. Account ownership almost doubled in just 2 years, from 29% in 2019 to 56% in 2021, the highest growth to date for the country. E-money users grew more than fourfold, from 8% in 2019 to 36% in 2021. As a result of the pandemic, 37% of adults started saving more for emergencies, and 60% of those with mobile phone and internet performed online financial transactions, such as fund transfers and payments, a significant jump from 17% in 2019. As the Philippines increasingly harnesses the potential of digital innovations, the focus of the work evolved from promoting access to financial services toward ensuring that these financial services truly enhance the financial health and resilience of their users. Government agencies, such as the Department of Social Welfare and Development, Department of Trade and Industry, and the Department of Interior and Local Government, are crucial partners in promoting digitalization among key target segments, such as the cash transfer beneficiaries and MSMEs.
Sa negosyo ko po, dito po sa Charings, syempre po, mabilis po, fast moving. Nakatulong po dito, nagkaroon po ng mga digital payment po na nag-launch po dito ang BSP, ang Bangko Sentral ng Pilipinas, na tinatawag po nila ng palengke QR code. Kasi ang palengke QR code ay mga digital payment para po ang mga mamamayan po, mga mamimili, na hindi po, na kahit po wala po silang available na dalang cash, eh makakapamili po pa sila dito po sa Mutyan ng Pasig Mega Market. Yung mga financial services po na pumasok po dito ay nakatulong po, lalo na po sa amin po bilang maliit na negosyante, kasi natulungan po kami na magkaroon ng loan, nadagdagan ng aming puhunan. At the same time, syempre, digital age na po tayo ngayon. Kailangan din po nating sumabay na hindi lang pwede nga puro cash, na lalo po mapagbuti at lalo po na maging progreso po ang aming negosyo. Kaya napaka malaking bagay po at tulong itong mga financial services na na-introduce po sa amin. Kasi sa tulong po nila, syempre, hindi po malilimitahan yung galoko po. Makakatulong po ito na hindi nyo lang po dito makikita sa Pasig and Charing, maaari ibang, sa ibang lugar po, na magkaroon lang po kami din ng mga iba pang branches. At the same time, makatulong din po kami sa mga sa employment, na mabigyan po namin ng trabaho ang mga ibang tao po na nangangailangan ng trabaho po sa ngayon. Sa tulong po ng mga financial services na dumating po, na nagpakilala po sa amin, na napaka-supportive po sa amin po sa ngayon, eh nakikita ko po na magtutuloy-tuloy at lalo pa po ito isang magiging successful po ko dahil sa mga tulong po nila, nadagdagan po ang aming mga puhunan. At kumbaga, yung services po namin na mapupuso na lalo pa namin po mapapaganda, yung serbisyo, yung mga produkto po namin, lalo pa po madadagdagan.
The power of technology is no longer just about efficiency gains that address geographical and economic barriers. We can harness the potential of data for deeper consumer insights to address product design suitability barriers. The goal is to make financial services more responsive and contextualized to the user's needs. Thus, building the innovation ecosystem is at the forefront of our inclusive digital finance efforts. Digital banking license was introduced in 2020 to attract digital forward market players. To empower consumer access to financial services through their data, the Open Finance Framework was launched in 2021 in coordination with the industry. The PhilSys, our digital ID system, is being implemented as a key enabler for these innovations to scale and benefit more consumers. To bolster digital connectivity in the underserved countryside, ICT policy reforms were introduced, such as the liberalization of the satellite technology for broadband services. As we further build this innovation ecosystem, we keep in mind that financial inclusion is a means to achieve broader aspirations. The goal goes beyond promoting universal access to financial services toward ensuring that these services truly enhance the financial health of Filipinos. We ensure that our efforts to green and promote sustainability in the financial sector benefit the vulnerable and underserved. Financial inclusion gives them the tools to build resilience in the face of climate shocks and other risks.
I now see a brighter future for all Filipinos, overseas workers, farmers, students, fisherfolk, employees, business owners who dream of a secure, stable, and comfortable life for their families. Seconds, hours, so many days. You know what you want, but how long can you wait? Every moment lasts forever. When you feel you lost your way, and what if my chances were already gone? Started believing that I could be wrong, but you give me one good reason to fight and never walk away. So here I am still holding on. With every step you climb another mountain, every breath is harder to believe. You make it through the pain, weather the hurricanes, to get to that one thing. Just when you think the road is going nowhere, just when you almost gave up on your dreams, they take you by the hand and show you that you can. There are no to the limit, to stand on the edge. What if today is as good as it gets? Don't know where the future's headed, but nothing's gonna bring me down. I've jumped every bridge, I've run every line, I've risked being saved, but I always knew why. I always knew why. So here I am. Climb another mountain. Every breath is harder to believe. You make it through the pain, weather the hurricanes,
to get to that one thing. Just when you think the road is going nowhere, just when you almost gave up on your dreams, they take you by the hand and show you that you can. You can go higher, you can go deeper. There are no boundaries above and beneath you. Break every rule, cause there's nothing between you and your dreams. When every step you climb another mountain, every breath is harder to believe.
We still have a long way to go on our journey toward financial inclusion. But together, we can make the dreams and aspirations of every Filipino a reality in a dream toward having a brighter future. We are united in achieving our aspirations. Everyone moves forward. No one is left behind.
Kabilang ako.
Kabilang ako.
Kabilang ako.
Kabilang ako.
Kabilang ako.
Kabilang ako.
You can go higher, you can go deeper. There are no boundaries above and beneath you. Break every rule, cause there's nothing between you and your dream. Oh. With every step you climb another mountain, every breath is harder to believe. You make it through the pain, weather the hurricane. There are no boundaries.
Gentlemen, our talented Filipino performers, the Ramon Ubusan Folkloric Group, Mr. Popper Bernadas, Malaya Dance Theater, Mandaluyong Children's Choir, El Gama Penumbra, and the Bangko Sentral Singers. Gentlemen, is only the start of the 2023 AFI Global Policy Forum. As we move on to the different plenary sessions, may we request everyone to remain seated
as we ask our governors and the official party of Secretary Rex Gatchalian to move on to their respective different venues that they have to be in. Very good. Everyone, we will break for a brief tea break. You can have that at the reception hall right across this venue.